pump overs. We had the first sort of solid weekend this weekend of pump overs where we had like working midnight, like long hours. Had to work out a team to do the different pump overs. But yeah.
What times are you doing pump overs?
First one in the morning, 7 o'clock, and then we are back here at 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, come back 8 o'clock, I mean 6 o'clock in the evening, and then we do a midnight pump over. Guys are getting tired, but we just sort of
play. How long does it pump over last? How long does it take?
In the beginning stages, your first ones would normally run about 4 times a day per tank.
Yes.
And depending on the tank volume, anything between 25 and 45 minutes on a tank, that's 4 times a day. And if you have 6 or 8 tanks running in a cellar, it's quite a hectic story.
It's a long period.
It's a long period, yeah. And so the whole floor is just covered in pumps and containers in which we drop the juice and pump them back up into the tanks, which is important. You need to do your pump overs, and I like to do it in the beginning stages enough to extract color, to extract flavor, to stabilize the color of the wine, to aerate the juice so that the yeast can survive and the oxygen that it needs to feed on. And I enjoy it. That's really the major part of.
Would you then keep pump overs 4 times a day per variety, or do the varieties?
No, it depends. Well, 4 times a day means that in the beginning stage of your pump overs, where you're running at balance of at that stage, let's say 21 to 16 belling, at that stage you would still do 4 times a day. But as the sugar gets converted into alcohol and the bellings drop, you cut down on your number of times per day, and you also cut down on your length of time per pump over.
Okay.
So eventually after, let's say, 7, 8 days, you may end up on that specific tank doing 1 pump over a day, and maybe just for 5 minutes, because by then you've got all the color that you needed.
Okay.
Your juice is stable, your color is stable, everything is there. Your ferment's basically done. So the oxygen that you needed for the ferment to feed on, you don't need it anymore. So now you start to sort of to handle it more protective. In other words, you start thinking now of keeping it away from the oxygen.
Yeah.
You'd rather sort of, because during fermentation, obviously there's lots of CO2 generation in the top of the tank.
Yeah.
And really that is why you aerate the wine, to get it away from the CO2 for a while and to get the oxygen for the yeast to feed on.
So as you're getting closer to the period that it goes into barrel, you start slowing down.
Yeah, because what the carbon dioxide does in the fermentation stage, it's also one aspect of protection.
Yeah.
Because oxygen in any sort of beverage can lead to oxidation,
yeah.
But it's not a worry in the tank at that stage. But as the ferment sort of finishes off, the wine goes dry.
Yeah.
Then you don't need oxygen, because if you get oxygen at that stage, you may run into problems of getting your wine oxidized and so on.
Yeah.
So you swing your whole process around,
yeah.
And you start getting it more protected.
So when they go into barrel, you obviously that's when they need to go and relax and develop.
All and your top quality grapes, or which is going to lead to maybe hopefully a top quality wine, you would do after your primary ferment, leave the juice and the skins for another week and a half, 2 weeks, depending on the flavor development in that period, depending on the tannin development. And it's a matter of tasting every day and evaluating every day, because you need to take it off the skins at the right time. If you leave it too long, it can lead to too high tannins or bitterness, those kind of off flavors which you don't really need. So it's a constant sort of monitoring of the whole sort of process.